Tonight, as I'm sure you know by now, I'm going to be hosting another Sheila on Stage, this time at the Heritage Hall in Vancouver, and my featured guest will be Dr. David Suzuki. Leading up to the event, I asked for your suggestions for another individual to appear on stage with us, someone the country should get to know or know better. We had many letters, including this from Victoria Otten. She writes, "My recommendation would be Professor William Rees from the University of British Columbia. He's the architect of the concept of ecological footprint, a tool used around the world. It seems he received little attention in his home country. He's a dynamic speaker full of ideas and opinions." One of several letters, actually, that we had recommending Professor Rees, and he is with me in our studio now. Good morning.
Good morning, Sheila.
Thank you very much for coming in, Bill.
Oh, it's just delightful to be up at this dawn cracking hour.
Well, now you've revealed the great secret of Sounds Like Canada as we go live to the East Coast, and here it is 9 minutes after six. You're not an early riser, you mean?
Well, not quite this early.
Not quite this early. Well, thank you again very much for coming in. I have a little newspaper clipping here from a column by David Suzuki, his suggestions on how to be greener, and at the bottom is a picture of a couple of footprints. Your idea right there, given literal image. Does it still please you that this is a term that has come to be understood and known widely?
Well, it really is very, very gratifying. In fact, the concept is gathering momentum as we speak, and I think probably there's no country in the world now that in some way hasn't been confronted by or has to deal with its ecological footprint.
I'd like to know how you became interested in ecological issues. I actually know that there was a moment where you sat down to a dinner and you began to think about the food you were eating.
Yeah, I was probably among the last generations of Canadians that had any really direct contact with the land. I was one of eight cousins who grew up and at least spent a good deal of our time, all our summer holidays, Easter, Christmas, on a farm in southern Ontario. And we were really the cheap labor. We worked our buns off from dawn till dusk very often. I have loaded hay onto a horse-drawn wagon with a pitchfork, milked cows by hand, gathered eggs in a basket, done it all. And one morning in early July, I think I was probably 8 or 10 years old, we were all gathered around my grandmother's big country kitchen in the porch. And I was just idly staring at my plate, waiting for my granddad to come in. He always said grace, so we had to sit respectfully until that moment occurred. And for whatever reason, as my eyes just wandered over the plate, it occurred to me that there wasn't a single thing on it, and it was heaped with everything because we had two huge meals a day. There wasn't a thing on that plate that I hadn't had a hand in growing. And for some reason, that thought struck me like nothing I had ever thought of before. It was as if someone had broken the cable in an elevator. I just felt I was sinking deeply into the earth, and I felt this profound connection with the soil, with the land, and realize, the old saying today is, we are what we eat. But this was an epiphany for me. It struck me like nothing else I'd ever thought.
Did you eat what was before you?
You know what? I almost couldn't eat that day. I was so overwhelmed by this experience. I remember a feeling that it was almost disrespectful to eat at that point. At any rate, the feeling passed. It was just one of those things, and I was young, and off we went. But years later, I guess a decade later, when I was deciding what to do with university, I never thought I'd get to go, but I won a scholarship. And so, my goodness, I was university bound and wondering what ought I to do. And this whole experience came back. It was as if it was just a replay of my youthful experience, and I realized I have to go into biology and ecology. So that's what I did. I wound up going through all the way to my PhD in population ecology.
There wasn't something called human ecology at that point.
Well, no, there was, but it was more sociology out of Chicago, and it had nothing to do with biology. Mm-hmm. So, no, you couldn't study human beings in a department of zoology, because we live in a culture that's deeply dualistic. It's called Cartesian dualism. There's a philosophical starting point for most of our environmental analyses that humans aren't part of nature. And so when I wanted to study people as a zoologist, I was told, well, that's the domain of economics or sociology or anthropology. You can't really do it here. And that's still the case. 90% of what passes as ecology today is of non-human species. Only a few systems ecologists really look at humans as if they were part of nature.
Everything you have done subsequent to your PhD, though, has bumped into economics, hasn't it?
Oh, of course, because in effect, ecology and economics have the same root in the Greek for the household, oikos. And so economics is de facto human ecology. But there's a great irony here, because ecologists who study non-human species in relation to their ecosystems have decent theory in physics, chemistry, biology. Economists who don't study nature at all, really, who study exclusively people, have terrible theory when it comes to transformation of material and environmental relationships. To economists, ecological damage is a so-called externality. It occurs outside of the marketplace. So, in effect, neither discipline has had much useful to say about sustainability, for example, because the one with good theory doesn't really study people, and the one with lousy theory when it comes to ecological interaction doesn't study nature. So we've got a bit of a dilemma here, and we're still in the verge of solving it.
There's externality and outside of the market, but there's also inside an electoral term. Do you think that that is something that has slowed the acceptance of the idea of climate change, global warming, and sustainability?
Oh, I think there are a huge number of things that really prevent us from getting our minds around the fact that we're in very deep trouble globally, ecologically. One thing is that human beings have evolved to be very socially conservative. If you think back 1,000 years, 10,000 years, nothing happened. You could live your entire life, even if you got to be 90 years old, and the
technology, which would have been a miracle, right?
Well, that the technologies at the time of your birth would be the same at the time of death. The people you knew, the cultural, everything would pretty much be the same. So if you think about it, there wasn't much advantage in changing anything, because if you were alive, if your little tribe or whatever it was surviving, clearly they found some way of making out in whatever environment they had involved. So there's probably strong selection pressure for fairly conservative social behavior. Well, leap ahead to the present day, and the very nature of our relationship with nature has changed it so rapidly that it now is changing so rapidly that we can't keep up culturally. So here we are in a situation where our social, our political, our geopolitical environment is changing at an enormous rate. Our ecological environment is changing at an enormous rate, and we're still Cro-Magnon men, stuck back with a very slow response time, so that there's a natural predisposition not to want to change dramatically, even in the face of difficult decisions, difficult change. Of course, there's the political problem as well, the power problem. Our governments are really much more beholden to large corporate interests with an enormous stake in the status quo than they are to the electorate. So it's even in the government's interest to keep the electorate relatively ignorant about the true state of our affairs, because that reduces pressure on them for change. And we're now seeing another mechanism coming into play. People who study human cognitive development are beginning to realize that early in the development of the individual, the social relationships, the expectations, economic expectations, cultural expectations, and so on, that a person experiences as he or she grows up, actually helps to shape the synapses of our brain. It forms the way we think about the nature of reality. And again, this was adaptive 100,000 years ago, 50,000 years ago, when nothing happened. You sort of developed the proper brain wiring to live in the culture in which you were born. Well, what happens to us today is that once these synaptic circuits are in place, we tend to seek out experiences that reinforces them. We want to have those warm and fuzzy feelings of comfort, of familiarity, and so on. This means that when data come in that are against our way of thinking, we reject the data and we keep the frames, so that we're in a situation where we almost have a built-in cognitive filter for bad news. So look at all of that. We've got a culture that has a I guess, a history of material success for the last couple of years. We have enormous invested interests in the maintaining the status quo. Most of us are predisposed not to want to change anyway. We see a neurological mechanism that reinforces that. So even though the windows are breaking and the doors are being knocked down and we're up to our knees in water, we can't recognize that there's a flood and storm about to break above our heads.
Is part of that an eco-fatigue? I mean, you're coming in here with bad news. I'm going to speak with David Suzuki tonight. He'll have bad news. Professor John Robinson also bad news.
Well,
come on.
No, I don't think it's bad news, frankly. I think it's good news. You see, what really has to happen here is that we come to recognize those forces that make us who we are and what we are. If we think of these kinds of things as nothing but bad news and do nothing about it, we've learned nothing. But if we understand why it is that we respond to it this way, we may actually get beyond our initial response and think through what we really need to do to move forward here. Almost nothing that we're doing in the domain of so-called sustainability today is doing anything but making the situation worse, because it's coming out of this resistance to change. We will do almost anything to keep our SUVs on the road, including converting a good proportion of our food crops into a form of fuel that makes the ecological circumstances worse, while deluding ourselves into thinking that driving ethanol-powered vehicles is improving air quality, which it isn't, and is reducing carbon dioxide emissions, which it isn't. Yet we've created an illusion that enables us to keep doing exactly what we're doing now. Everybody's happy. We think we've solved the problem. We've done nothing of the kind. And as I say, the waters are rising around our knees.
I'm speaking with Professor William Rees from the University of British Columbia, and you're listening to Sounds Like Canada on CBC Radio 1. I have to get how you came to the term ecological footprint.
Well, as I explained a moment ago, I'd always had this fascination with our relationship to landscape, to the land directly. And so I gave a little seminar when I had first come to UBC about something called carrying capacity. Biologists define carrying capacity as the number of organisms, individuals in a herd of elk or deer or cattle for that matter, that could live in a particular habitat without wrecking that habitat. Now it's a kind of loosey-goosey concept, but it does a certain element of intuitive sensibility to it. And I was struggling to find ways of applying what I had learned as an ecologist to the human circumstance. So I did a quick and dirty estimate of the carrying capacity of the lower mainland of BC, just based on what we knew about agricultural and forestry productivity and current rates of consumption and so on. And it turned out we could support maybe 35 to 50,000 people here. I gave this paper in a forum, and one of Canada's top resource economists happened to be in the audience, and he took me aside afterwards and in the most collegial manner, with the best of intention, told me that, look, Bill, he said, that was an interesting presentation, but I have to tell you, if you insist on pursuing this line of research, your career at UBC is going to be nasty, bitter, and short. And he went on to explain that economists had long since banished the concept of carrying capacity from the discussion of the human condition. After all, we had technology and could overcome any constraints imposed by nature. And what we couldn't do through technology, we could do through trade. Why should the lower mainland be restricted to what we can grow or whatever here if we can import stuff from elsewhere? Now, to be honest, our science education isn't that great in Canada, North America. We're very narrowly trained. These seem like simple arguments, but I'd never heard them before. And of course, they made a great deal of sense. I went away with my tail between my legs, thinking that, well, maybe carrying capacity has nothing to offer. But, you know, a couple of years later, and it took that long, I'm not really very bright, you see. I woke up in the middle of the night with one of those light bulbs shining over my head, and I realized, I can get around this argument. It had always bothered me. There was something just not right about it. Simply by inverting the carrying capacity ratio. So instead of asking how many people can this area support, the question becomes how much area is needed to support this many people, wherever on Earth that area might be. And that was my aha moment. And it made me then instantly begin to understand that if I could somehow impart in or turn trade flows into the equivalent land area, we could put together some kind of concept or an index that might show how much land was needed to support a population. So I called that at first because I began to teach this idea by asking students to imagine what would happen to a city, as we normally define city, if it were enclosed in a bell jar. an impermeable glass capsule. And so this became the regional capsule concept, because anybody would realize that a city in a bell jar is dead within a few days, few hours perhaps. It would suffocate and starve at the same time, because in strictly ecological terms, cities aren't productive. They're not the engines of national economic growth, except insofar as they need a huge amount of fuel from the outside of the city to sustain it. So if you increase that bell jar so that it contains a sufficiently large area of diverse ecosystem types, it will eventually get to a size which could actually support the consumptive activities going on in the city. And that size would be what I then called the regional capsule of the city. It then became, for a short while, in my mind at any rate, the human impact index. But then one day, I got a new computer. I'd had a big flat one on my desk that took up a whole lot of space, and the department, I think it was the last time UBC actually bought us a computer, and gave us some new tower models. And I was thrilled by this because I had a lot more room on my desk, and a colleague walked in. I happened to be writing one of the early papers on eco-footprints when he asked, "Hey, you got your new computer, how do you like it?" I said, "I like it fine, you know, it's got such a small footprint." And as soon as I said that word, I knew I had my concept, a name that would, it's a metaphor that people just connect with right away. So I went through that paper and changed every reference to the Human Development Impact Index or the regional capsule to ecological footprint. And it took off from there. I think there's such power in a wonderful metaphor that if I had continued to call it the Human Impact Index, you'd not be talking to me today.
Well, and it's in the Oxford Dictionary
it
of
is.
The English language
Indeed.
Now, too. Congratulations.
Yes.
I understand it only takes 11 public references to enable something to be eligible, but there have been many, many more than that. And in many, many languages as well.
Yes, we're in about 10 languages now, I think, in the book.
You've talked about two of your epiphanies so far, Bill. What are you wrestling with right now that might lead to an epiphany? What's preoccupying your thoughts at night?
Well, I really wonder whether we're going to pull it off. I've read a great deal about the history of previous civilizations, and if anyone wants to kind of catch up with a recent book Jared Diamond published in 2005, one called Collapse: How Societies Choose to Fail or Succeed. And the key word in that subtitle is choose. Do we actually choose? Are we choosing today to fail or succeed? Or is the system just so complex now that we're global, now that we have to really come together around this as this is a collective problem, sustainability. You cannot solve it as an individual. You cannot solve it through a competitive model. And yet we've created in the world today an increasingly individualistic, dog-eat-dog, competitive model of just about everything, which is precisely the wrong way to approach a collective problem that needs agreement across the board about the nature of the problem. It needs to share the pain as well as the gain. And yet we don't have in place the international mechanisms, the legal institutions. The United Nations seems to be fraying at the edges. Good heavens, we're in precisely the wrong geopolitical state to solve a macro problem that affects every one of us. So I wonder whether the human mind is actually capable of grasping the complexity of the situation that we have. It's entirely possible, as the scope of the system, the scale of the system, the complexity of the system reaches the point where we haven't got the human capability to cope with it. We have the behavioral problems I mentioned earlier. We're still an animal. We're still an organism. And in a sense, we're being defeated by our own success. We've been inordinately successful as a species in appropriating resources and diverting them and converting them into our own selves and into our infrastructure. And we're still being driven by the same things that made us successful 50,000 years ago. We can't turn them off, even though they've now become maladaptive. And I think this is a real key to understanding this. The very things that led us to really depart from all other organisms in terms of our social organization, our cultural organization, the accumulation of technology, these are uniquely human qualities, which were hugely adaptive 25, 10,000, 1,000 years ago. But now that they've so much changed the nature of the world in which we live, the same drivers have become maladaptive. That's an enormously difficult problem, and we need to raise that to consciousness if we're ever to be able to assert ourselves, our intellect, over the biological predispositions to calm a calm us down and come to grips with the fact that this is really a global problem that requires global solutions. It's not going to be solved by individuals taking showers together or eating organic food. We need massive government intervention in our own economy, in the international economy. That's what fascinates me now. Do we have the wherewithal to organize in a way that meets the challenge ahead of us? There's a very well-known law among systems analysts, at least it used to be well-known, called Ashby's Law of Requisite Variety. And it says that the internal variety, the diversity, the capacity of a management system must be equivalent to that of the system being managed. And the larger the system gets, the more complex the management problem becomes. And as we see in the world today, the problems are getting bigger and we're withdrawing governance. We're destroying our capacity to manage. We're breaking, in the United States, is disregarding and abrogating many international treaties. So again, I think we're going...
Canada's not without blame either.
Oh, no, of course not. I don't want to put a finger here on the United States, but they are rather more evident in the world than say, Canada is at this time. So I think we're going backwards in many respects as the problem gets bigger and bigger. It's more difficult than any of us ever imagined it could become.
I have a minute before a computer says, you don't talk anymore. Optimistic or pessimistic?
Oh, I think optimism and pessimism are both states of mind that have absolutely nothing to do with the nature of reality.
Perfect.
We need to be realistic. And to be realistic requires that we get serious about sustainability. We're not serious about urban sustainability. We're not serious about national sustainability. And we're sure as hell not serious about global sustainability right now.
I think you should get up every morning at 5 o'clock because you're on fire by 6. Thank you so much for joining me this morning, Bill.
It's been an absolute pleasure.
Great pleasure for me. William Reese is a professor with the School of Community and Regional Planning at the University of British Columbia. He's a founding member of the Canadian Society for Ecological Economics and the originator of the concept.